Take my life. Please stand.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, in the abasement of your Son, have raised up a fallen world. Fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those who have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Consequently, brothers and sisters, we are not debtors to the flesh, but live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if the Spirit, if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stayed up all night. I was just too excited.
And instead of making us, or letting us sleep, they sent us busy touring the city of Rome after we got there. I was like, so by the end of the day, I was really, really tired. So hit the sack, got up the next morning, and we were going to go to the catacombs of St. Priscilla in Rome. Used to be in the old days outside the city of Rome, in the countryside, but now it's in a subdivision. So you drive through the subdivision, all of a sudden it's this catacombs area. But while we were going there, we were going to do morning prayer. So I was sitting there with the text, bouncing around in the city of Rome. I'm not supposed to. It's like the street turned upside down. And it came on very suddenly. We parked in the catacombs. I was like, don't touch me, you know. So everyone left the bus, and I was the last one. And the bus driver came up and tapped me and said in his best English, "You need to get off the bus now, or you have to stay by yourself. We're going down to the catacombs." And I looked at myself and I said, "Buddy, you've come all this way to see the catacombs. Get well instantly." So I stood up and I walked off the bus, but made it okay. And as I got down into the catacombs, it was nice and cool, and I began to feel better. So the catacombs of Priscilla are not necessarily as well preserved as some of the others. All of the stucco that was used to seal the tombs in the ancient times all gone, as are all the remains. So there's catacombs are stacked about five high. They're kind of like ours, except they're like this way and not this way, okay? So we went around the corner. It's rather a drab looking place, despite the fact what it once was. And then we rounded a corner and we're up above one of the empty cells, one of the empty tombs, was a magnificent mosaic with bowls, with trees, with birds, and flowers, and fruit, and fountains. And the tour guide said, "We do not know who was buried there, but we do know one thing. That person was a martyr for the faith." My legs turned to jello again. Just the notion that I was able to stand in the presence of the tomb of someone who had given life of Christ in the early church. The martyrs, as we've always been taught, even since we were children, they're our heroes. And there I was standing in front of the tomb of one of these early Christian heroes. We do not know what this person's name was. We do not know if that person was a man or a woman. We do not know if that person was wealthy in the society or not, but they treated the martyrs all alike. That person could have been a slave in Roman society and still got the same treatment from the community. So I began thinking about this, and I was wondering, what would that person have thought about the readings if that person had heard them today? Maybe they did hear them, perhaps. Certainly they may have heard them back in the early days, maybe at the liturgy, a priest was preaching, and he talked about Zechariah's prophecy of the humble king who was prophesied by the prophet, which was fulfilled, of course, in the coming of Jesus Christ. And that first reading, of course, is what we hear on Sunday, that it was prophesied by Zechariah that the king would come and he would be humble, riding on a donkey into Jerusalem. Now, that priest may have explained to the ancient congregation that in ancient Israel, the king, as he was crowned, did not enter the city on a war horse, like his confreres in the ancient world, but on the donkey to remind himself that God is the king, and that God dwells in the temple of Jerusalem. And so he was crowned as a humble man on a donkey. Also, the prophet may have certainly been explained in this way, that the symbols that come afterward are calamities that happened to ancient Israel. It says that he would banish chariot from Ephraim, which is the northern kingdom, where the Assyrians had once conquered the people and dispersed them. And then the horse from Jerusalem. Jerusalem had fallen to Babylon in the 6th century. some of the people were conquered in the 8th century B.C., some were conquered in the 6th century B.C., and they were led off into exile. They knew that life was fragile. So the ancient priests may well have explained that to our future martyr, that life can be difficult. It was for the people of Israel. It was for the early Christians who were under the boot of Rome. And they were an illegal sect, and that they could be put to death for their faith. And yet, perhaps the ancient presbyter explained that Christ is the Prince of Peace, and that his teaching will bring someday peace to the whole of humanity. From the great river Euphrates to the ends of the earth, is what the ancient prophet said, and that was a common phrase that meant everywhere, all over the earth, that Jesus is the teacher and the Prince of Peace, the humble king. And then perhaps maybe our martyr would have sat in a catechetical session after his baptism and had the faith expounded to him or her. The teacher, the catechist, may have said, "You are not debtors to the flesh." As Paul says, we are in Christ. We are not the flesh, we are in the Spirit. And when do we receive the Spirit? We receive the Spirit in baptism when we sink into the paschal waters and unite ourselves to Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection, and we rise to new life. We are in the Spirit. We are not in the flesh. And Paul makes that distinction. He says, the Spirit is those things that lift us up and bring us closer to the Lord, while the flesh are those earthly things that we need to avoid. That's all Paul is trying to say. It is speaking also of baptism and the power of baptism that transforms us, transforms all the Christians back through the ages of the early days when our martyr suffered martyrdom. And imagine the trial that would have taken place when our martyr would have gone before a judge and been told, choose Christ and you die. Choose the gods of Rome and you live. To have heard that martyr say bravely, even if perhaps she had had a wife, a husband, and children, or even if he had had a family, that they had to forsake all of that. And the phrase that they would then say, I choose Christ. And then it would be very simple, because the Romans are very efficient in dispatching people. It was simply a question of where would they go for their torture and their death. And one wonders, was that death quick one by the sword, or perhaps the martyr had to carry the cross beam like Jesus to the hill of crucifixion? And assuming that was the case, that our martyr knew the words of Jesus, my yoke is easy and my burden is light, as he or she carried the cross beam to death. For yokes are made for two. Two oxen on a yoke, right? Jesus is saying that if the other side of the yoke is dragging the ground, you're being stifled by it, Jesus says, I will get under myself and lift the burden for you and help you. Perhaps Jesus said in the heart of the martyr at that moment, my Father and the Spirit lifted me up as I carried the cross to Calvary. I will be there for you. That person, whoever he or she was, whose name is known to God, closed with his or her eyes in death. Jesus promised us that he would be with us. I give you praise, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have not revealed it to the wise and the clever, but to the merest children. Such, Father, was your good pleasure. Everything has been given over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son and the Father. No one knows the Father but the Son, and whoever the Son chooses to reveal him to. Come to me. Here it is in Greek. I discovered that. Δες και προσμε πάντες, κοπιόντες, υπερφόρτισμενοι, ακόμα ρωτάξω, he mocks. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavily burdened, I will refresh you. Take a yoke upon yourselves and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart. You will find rest, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And would not have a martyr have seen this smiling, loving, gentle face of the Lord when he or she closed his or her eyes in death at the end of the life they had lived, confessing Christ to the end, putting faith in Christ, knowing that Christ gives us comfort, gives us hopefulness, gives us life, even in our darkest hour. Believe in one God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from God. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom by their will. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. Who of the Father and the Son is the Lord over Father, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess in baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Many in our world are in need of the comfort that comes only from God. Let us pause now and call to mind those who long for the presence of the Lord.
That the church will continue to be a place where those who are heavily burdened may come for peace and refreshment. We pray to the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
That peacemakers will be strengthened for their work and will teach us the ways of peace. We pray to the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
That those who travel will arrive at their destination safely. We pray to the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
That our parish community will be a place of refuge for those who are burdened in any way.
Hear us, O
Lord. That the dead will be granted eternal rest in heaven, especially Lydia Keller, we pray to the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord. Hear us in our need, O God, peace, and answer the prayers that are deep within our hearts. We ask this in Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please join in singing the offertory song, "Eye Has Not Seen."
goes forth in marvelous works, by which in our weakness you perfect your power, and on the feeble bestow strength to bear your witness to Christ our Lord, and so with the powers of heaven. We worship you best in the earth, and before your majesty without end we acclaim.
Yeah.
Christ has said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. With God our sons, and all the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace and the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign. Thank you. come to that?
Yeah.
Also, a reminder, everyone, please be safe driving on the highways coming back yesterday. There was a serious accident north of Montgomery, and backed up traffic there. And, it wasn't an accident, but they had construction backing up traffic at I-10 from the Pearl River Bridge almost to Diamond Head. So that was difficult for people, including myself. And then there was a bad accident on the expressway yesterday evening, which had a lot of people turning around. So when I was coming up last week, right before Mass, traffic was really bad because people were turning back to Long Green Peak. So please be careful driving this summer. It's really rough out there. Also, any of you who have lost a loved one or lost of any kind, spouse, child, or miscarriage, girlfriend, grandparent, sibling, or some other crisis in your life, and you're looking for hope or peace, my good friend, Jill Bahi, one of my mentors, is a longtime DRE over at American Peace in Mandeville. She's the brief minister for the Archdiocese, and she's sponsoring retreats, and that's coming up on August 19th and 20th. It's going to be at the Synagogue of the Archdiocese of the Retreat House at the end of the Transcontinental Battery on the lakefront. And they have Mass on the Sunday, and yes, it's doing the Mass. So I encourage any of you who might be grieving at this point to certainly contact the school and get on that retreat. That information is going to be in the bulletin next week. So it's still a little bit ahead. It's not the end of what third or fourth week of August. Let us pray. For every prayer, Lord, and having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you through Christ our Lord. Rather the sick and humble, technically, not only the sacrament we have celebrated, but also the word of God, as we've heard, as well as the affection of this parish community. Ask for the prayers of those who visit, return to the well with God's peace and bless. Let us now recite the prayer for the new Battle of New Orleans, living in faith for God. Through the years, the people of our Archdiocese have appreciated the prayers of God. In times of war and disaster, epidemic, illness, we come to you, Father, with Mary, our mother, and ask you to help us in the battle of today against violence, murder, and racism. We implore you to give us your wisdom, that we may build a community founded on the values of Jesus, which gives respect to the life and dignity of all people. Bless parents that they may form their children in faith. Bless and protect our youth that they may be peacemakers of our time. Give consolation to those who lost loved ones through violence. Hear our prayer, give us a perseverance, to be a voice for life and human dignity in our community. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Now let it pass out. Brother, are we at the lead? Amen. Pray to St. Michael, St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. May our defense against the wickedness, the snares of the devil. May God rebuke and we humbly pray. We do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, trust in the hell of Satan, and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth in peace. The Mass is ended.
Thank you.
Have a great day, a great week, everyone. Hope you had a great 4th of July.
Our closing song is number 545 in the hymn. 5, 4, 5. Join singing, Companions on the Journey.